In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. My Lord and my God, I firmly believe that you are here, that you see me, that you hear me. I adore you with profound reverence. I ask the pardon for my sins and the grace to spend this time of prayer fruitfully. My Immaculate Mother, and Joseph, my Father and Lord, my guardian angel, intercede for me. In our prayer today, the week mediating between the ascension of our Lord and the coming of the Holy Spirit on Pentecost, what could be the last week of this series of No Greater Love? It doesn't have to be the last meditation. We can always continue, even perhaps with less frequency. But in our prayer today, we will continue considering the action of the Holy Spirit in our soul. As we await his arrival, we can ask him to be for us, as we say in the sequence, in labore requies, in estu temperies, in fleto solatium. In our labor, rest most sweet, grateful coolness in the heat, solace in the midst of woe. Thus we ask for those things which a relationship with God brings to a soul that has given itself completely. Peace, serenity, and calm. We have good reason to seek them, for we know that habitual serenity and mastery over our passions, in work, in suffering, and in temptation, is indispensable for a contemplative soul. I would even put that the other way around, that those are the marks of a contemplative soul. The docility to the actions of the Paraclete leads to identification with the Spirit of Jesus Christ and with our Lord. There can be no agitation. There can be no anxiety. The fruit of being in order is peace. Even if it's a consequence of war, it's a consequence of struggle, we need to get there. So much so that the lack of peace, anxiety, being perturbed, or not to say not even being able to sleep unless it's really a physiological disorder, is like the vital sign, the same way that doctors look at your pulse and your blood pressure and things like those. The lack of peace, the lack of serenity, or not to say the lack of joy, are telltale signs that something is amiss. Of course, the reaction to that is not to get more agitated and to get more worried, but rather with a lot of humility and piety, to go to the open arms of our Heavenly Father, or to lean our head on the chest of our Lord, like the beloved disciple did during the Last Supper. Oh, my Lord, what would have moved the beloved disciple to lay his head on the chest of our Lord during the Last Supper? Think of it, and you will see it immediately. It's precisely that lack of peace. It's precisely that sorrow, that anxiety, that uncertainty of what was going to happen next. We men are not given to this kind of a reaction, but women are. That's the reason why women are so pious. Even in a conjugal relationship, in a relationship between a man and a woman, you see it in movies, you have experienced it yourselves. Or even those of you who are not married, when you've dated, You know very well that women, they lean on the man. They rest. It's such a, that's the reason why it had to be the beloved disciple. Any older apostle wouldn't have done it, because precisely it's kind of a feminine reaction to rest your head on the chest of a friend, your boyfriend, your husband, or of a young person. And the beloved disciple was young, was adolescent. And feeling the insecurity, the uncertainty of what was in the air, what was in the offing, he was resting his head, looking for peace. Why do you think our Lord has remained with us in the tabernacle? Why do you think our Lord has gone to the extent of becoming so helpless in the Holy Eucharist, subjecting himself at the same time to all the risk of the not only indifference but downright sacrilege that happens in some places, unfortunately, precisely because of his helplessness? Once, many years ago, I made a visit to a what was supposed to be a perpetual adoration chapel somewhere in Quezon City, which was kind of in the open, not in the open as in under the sky, no, but it was in a some sort of almost like a veranda structure, an extension of the church, accessible to anyone who would go there. Well, so I went there to pay a visit to our Lord, and I realized how open to sacrilege it was. And besides, our Lord was exposed in the monstrance, and there was nobody there. The reason why there is a monstrance, the reason why our Lord is put in the open, that's why it's called a perpetual adoration chapel, because there are people who are adoring. And what should be done in a situation like that is to have a roster of volunteers to make sure that 24/7 there's someone there. Our Lord should never be left alone, much less exposed like that. And so going to that, I was kind of disturbed by the whole arrangement. And I internally, I complained to him. Lord, why do you expose yourself to such indignities? In the depth of my heart, I felt a soft reply, which I will never forget for the rest of my life. As if our Lord telling me, because I knew you'd be here. My brothers and sisters, I would like to think that even for the sake of just one soul who would want to visit him in the Blessed Sacrament, conscious of what he's doing, meaning to say, therefore, with an act of love, with an attitude of love, not only of adoration and worship, our Lord would have been willing to institute this, the Blessed Sacrament, the Holy Eucharist. Well, that's the reason why these days of the pandemic, when many people find it difficult to make a visit to the Blessed Sacrament, they feel the absence. They feel the anxiety. They feel the weakness. Our Lord knew that, and that's the reason why he instituted that sacrament. Was first of all, in order to perpetuate the sacrifice of Calvary. But as you know very well, the Holy Eucharist can be taken in three aspects. Sacrifice, but also communion, and presence, permanence, tabernaculum. He has made his abode with us. Once, Saint Jose Maria, speaking to his children on Opus Dei, said, "My dear children, be serene in your work and in your spiritual life. For the love of God, be faithful. Don't be childish or crazy. Live in the presence of God as contemplative souls must, and as our vocation requires us to do." peace in our Lord. To get into the habit of resting our head in His bosom. If not physically, because we can't go to the Blessed Sacrament Chapel, spiritually. Get into the habit of storming. This is again another expression of St. Jose Maria, storming tabernacles. Asaltando sagrarios in Spanish. Assaulting, asaltar. Because we don't only go there, we open it spiritually. We want to be inside with Him in that same tent. We know very well that the peace which our Lord gives does not consist in the absence of difficulties, but rather in our overcoming them with His help. The calmness, the peace and serenity which we ardently desire to receive from the Holy Spirit come from our filial relationship with God, which makes us feel secure and protected. Then we can say, the Lord is my light and my salvation, whom shall I fear? As a result, we are peaceful and calm. God comes with tranquility, but not with the false serenity of indifference or unconcern. The Puedena approach, the, shall we say, the kind of peace that Buddhism, for example, preaches. You picture those monks in saffron robes, spending the whole day concentrating on nothing with a heightened state of awareness. Awareness of what? If there's no object to that awareness, that's even very dangerous. It's the kind of centering prayer that you hear preached at times in an attempt to mix Christianity with Oriental mysticism. Meditation is something like that. The removal of distractions in order to focus in a heightened state of awareness, but to focus on something, not on nothing, which is what the centering prayer of Oriental mysticism does, which is to make the mind very, very aware, very conscious, but with no object. So therefore, it's like a vacuum, or perhaps a blank slate, but very ready to receive anything. And in a situation like that, even the devil can make inputs. And in the absence of points of reference to be able to judge what's right and what's wrong, what's from God and what's from the devil, because precisely the mind is blank, then it puts itself in grave danger, even of diabolic suggestion. But that's not the kind of prayer that we do. When we rest on our Lord, we open ourselves to the Holy Spirit. When we meditate on the gospel scenes, when we meditate on the truths of our faith, we make ourselves, yes, very aware and very, very conscious. But in order to receive insights, lights, inspirations from the Paraclete regarding those points that we are meditating on. Like today, for example, what are we meditating on? The serenity and peace that we have to get with our Lord. What are we meditating on? That scene of the Last Supper where the beloved disciple was resting his head on the chest of our Lord. And what are the inspirations that we are getting? Well, look at your own case. What lights you have received up to this moment of this prayer. And this we do 24/7. The children of God, St. Jose Maria said, even though they're always serene with the serenity of their divine filiation, cannot remain indifferent at the sight of a world which is not Christian and sometimes not even human. For many people have not yet attained the living conditions in the temporal order which permit spiritual development, and they are unaware of anything which is not carnal. The words of Scripture can be applied to them. words from St. Paul. They are worldly people devoid of the Spirit. What St. Paul lamented is fulfilled in these poor souls. Animalis autem homo non percipit ea quae sunt spiritus Dei. That the animal man does not perceive the things that come from the Spirit of God. What is our Lord trying to tell us now? What is St. Jose Maria opening our eyes to? He's trying to nuance the kind of peace that we have. As I said, it's not the peace of the Buddhist monk who is at peace with nothing, with no desires. It's the nirvana, which is the absence of all desires. It's the happiness of a piece of rock, for example, inert, not minding anything, because precisely it's a rock. But if you want to be like that, well, unfortunately, there are people who want to be like that. You know, the typical potato, poached potato, it's not just a poached potato. Now he is a garden variety stone. There are people like that, but that's unfortunate. And St. Jose Maria is telling us, we cannot be like that. Rather, we have to be open to our environment. We have to be conscious of our fellow men. And we have to know that there are many people who are anxious because of the uncertainty that comes from not having a relationship with God. Because really, without a relationship with God, my gosh, this world, this life, is not only a big joke, it's tragic. It's almost as tragic as the life of the chicken. Many years ago, I was staying in a center, and one of the residents was working with Rubina, Rubina Farms. And he was working in that section that was producing the day-old chicks. You know, you go to any poultry supply and you can buy day-old chicks. Apparently, you know, this is something that many people don't even think about, much less know, because they don't think about it, is that you have never heard of two-day-old chicks, right? Because what happens is the following. There's a department there, there's a section there, that predicts the demand for day-old chicks in a given day. Because when day-old chicks are produced, they're not inoculated, they're not vaccinated, they're not given anything, because the ones who buy them are supposed to be the ones who would put those starter shots. So therefore, if they're not bought within the day, they're kind of, what do you call this? Damaged, traumatized as it were, and nobody will buy them anymore. So what do? With the oversupply of the old chicks? Well, they're killed. But not killed as in disposed of, because it's a pity, that's protein. What's done, at least, what this person was doing, his department was doing, they drown them, and dry them, and ground them, and feed them back to their mothers. It's a terrible thing, right? That's why every time I think of people who exist just to be born, to study, and then to work, and then to get old and get decrepit, and then to die, and that's the end of it. I think of chickens. These chickens are cute, right? But you could also have thought of piglets and herd of cattle or sheep. Nowadays, they have a better use for unsold day-old chicks. They make them quack quack and they sell them there as a street food, deep fry them. Well, anyway, we can't live a life like that. God made man to his image, elevated him to his likeness by breathing into him the breath of life, his own spirit, his own breath, so that we may be holy and spotless in his presence in love. Now, approximating it and reaching it, living an eternity of that kind of an existence in what is called heaven. That is our destiny. But if we're going there, and if we know we're going there, and we're struggling to get there, applying the right means, then really, anything else is anecdotal. A war can happen, as it has happened, or they have happened. A pandemic can happen, as it's happening right now. There could be financial and economic upheavals, real tragedies in our family too. But all of those are anecdotes. For as long as we know we're going to heaven, for as long as we know that we are in the hands of God, we're in the embrace of the Blessed Trinity, that is the kind of certainty that we have. Not the certainty of what's going to happen next. We don't know that. And we will be anxious if we keep on dwelling on that. But certain that we are in the embrace of the Holy Spirit. That's a certainty. And because of that, we're at peace. Not at peace, as I said, with the peace of the rock, but with the peace of someone who knows in the right track and is getting there. But as we were considering a minute ago, we cannot be oblivious of other souls, of our brothers and sisters who are insecure, who are anxious, who are really, rightfully, truthfully suffering the consequences of a harsh environment. And we cannot close our eyes to that and just be happy, as I said, in our ivory tower. The real Spirit of Christ searches for the lost, looks for the lost sheep, for the injured lamb. The real Spirit of Christ goes to the peripheries. That's why he told the apostles, go to the very ends of Palestine and then beyond to the whole world to preach the good news, to bring the people to baptism, and to guide them to their eternal destiny. That's why the serenity which God gives us does not mean closing our eyes to reality. It means viewing it with optimism, trusting in the help of our Father in heaven. We need serenity and moderation in all our actions, because we too are threatened with the wrong kind of sadness, which may be produced by suffering, sickness, setbacks, and especially the weight of our own shortcomings. That's why St. Jose Maria wrote, among the gifts of the Holy Spirit, I would say that there is one which we all need in a special way, the gift of wisdom, which makes us know God and rejoice in his presence, thereby placing us in a perspective from which we can judge accurately the situations and events of this life. Because that's what wisdom is. It's the virtue that inclines a person to evaluate temporal realities in their relationship to the last end, to the true end. The wise person is the one who understands the realities around him as either good or bad, convenient or inconvenient, with reference to the last end. But that person will neither be crushed by passing, quote-unquote, evil, for as long as he knows that in the bigger picture, he is on the right track, nor falsely lulled into complacency just because things seem to be doing well, even if it were only a very, shall we say, transitory peace that he is in. Wise person always looks at his final destination. And so therefore, if something is difficult or even painful, for as long as it's leading him to the final, to the last end, to the true end, then he embraces it, not only tolerates it, embraces it. On the other hand, no matter how enjoyable or pleasurable a thing is, if he knows it's not convenient for his true end, then he lets go of it. That's the wise person. And you can understand, therefore, a person like that will embrace his own historicity, understanding that things are happen because God allows them. And since God is good, he's our Father, he's all wise and all powerful, if something happens, it must be for our good. Hence that saying again of St. Paul, diligentibus Deum, omnia, omnes cooperantur in bonum, omnia cooperantur in bonum. For those who love God, everything works together unto good. In this way, our spirit will never be stifled by the sadness which kills, which leads the imagination to wander all over the place, mulling over memories, conjuring up fantasies, seeking after consolations, and perhaps even complaining inwardly about our situation, our work, our ascetical struggle, and our dedication. The sadness that leads us to neglect one thing after another results in listlessness and indolence. It will disappear when the Holy Spirit shows us once and for all that in everything, God works for the good with those who love him, who are called according to his purpose. The faith that the Paraclete constantly nurtures in the soul of a Christian does not diminish his spirit or limit the noble impulse of his soul. Rather, it makes them grow with the realization of their true and authentic meaning. These are words from St. Jose Maria. We do not exist in order to pursue just any happiness. We have been called to penetrate the intimacy of God's own life, to know and love God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, and to love also in that same love of the one God in three divine persons, the angels and all men. That is the grace, or this rather, is the great boldness of the Christian faith, he concludes, to proclaim the value and dignity of human nature and to affirm that we have been created to achieve the dignity of children of God through the grace that raises us up to a supernatural level. An incredible boldness it would be, were it not founded on the promise of salvation given us by God the Father, confirmed by the blood of Christ, and reaffirmed and made possible by the constant action of the Holy Spirit. My brothers and sisters, in this week, which is the proximate preparation for Pentecost, after having just celebrated the Ascension, having meditated on that apostolic mission that we all have received to go and preach the good news to all nations, to bring souls to baptism, assured of the companionship of our Lord Jesus Christ after the end of time, let's fine-tune how we can put, shall we say, substance to these considerations that we have just made. First of all, the necessity of really struggling to align ourselves with the inspirations of God in our soul. Second, to move according to the will of God always. Third, to understand the circumstances happening around us as part and parcel, not just decorations, but structural parts, integral parts of the plan of God for our sanctification. And having realized that, therefore, to be happy, to be serene, and to be proactive. Meaning to say, not just putting up with this pandemic, but as I have repeated so many times in the course of these meditations, to grasp the bull by the horn, so to speak, to embrace our historicity in order to make of it all of these realities positive tools, instruments, integral parts for our own sanctification in the first place and for the sanctification of our environment. We have a few minutes left to finish the prayer.